Hey, good evening, everyone, or I'd rather say ni hao. We are celebrating a Chinese New Year tonight with Janet Z. Wang, the author of the Chinese Wine Renaissance. And I'm extremely, extremely happy to welcome her, as we have a few amazing wines from the most interesting terroirs of China, and also especially curated for this occasion, banquet box from the Luban kitchen. So please don't hesitate to comment and tell us where you are, what are your reflections on the wines and the food. Prepare your glasses, prepare your sticks, and welcome Janet.
Thank you, Martina. Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. And Happy New Year. And good evening. Ni hao, wan shang hao. So I'm very delighted to be back with 67 Palma again for Chinese New Year, Year of the Ox. Anything bovine in Chinese is called niu. So this year we're in a unique position to deploy a bilingual pun, which is Happy New Year, right? So Happy New Year, but also Happy Year of the Ox. So today, my talk will be mainly around several important regions, wine regions of China, but also because I know some of you are having a Chinese feast at home as well. We'll also talk about wine and food pairing using the Chinese five element system. So hopefully it will be something interesting to explore and to discuss. So first of all, let's just set the scene a little bit, which is to see where vineyards are to be found in China. And the short answer is pretty much everywhere, all over the place. As you can see from this map, the dots and their relative sizes indicate the relative planting areas of vineyards in China. And you can see they're generally in the north. And the green dots are the vitis vinifera varieties. And the red dots are the local or hybrid varieties. The other way of looking at the wine regions of China instead of provinces is by geographical region and features. You know, for example, the Yellow River Corridor or the Yellow River Old Path, you know, things like that, which describe a little more accurately about where these vineyards are located. And I'm just overlaying on top of that the cuisine styles of each of these regions. This is a little bit generalized, of course, but I think it's still quite useful to show you the cuisine styles and the predominant flavor profiles of the local cuisines. And then just for orientation, that's where Beijing is, where the duck is from. And on the eastern coast, of course, you can imagine we eat a lot of seafood around the coastal areas. The northern China is where people like to have lamb, right? So a lot of these famous wine regions like Ningxia, for example, they're very famous for lamb dishes. But of course, the all over China, we eat a lot of pork, right? So pork is the predominant meat. So having this in mind, let's just first set the scenes of looking at wine and food matching using the five elements, which is called wuxing. Wuxing in Chinese means five elements approach. And I'm sure you're all familiar with the usual, you know, wood, fire, earth, metal, water framework of talking about five elements. And of course we can put on top of that the five major flavor profiles and call them the five elements. So sour, or in wine language we talk about acidic, acidity more, and bitter, which is tannins, the sweet profile, and then umami and spice, and savory and mineral in one group. So we can superimpose the flavor elements onto the five elements. But really, that's not terribly exciting or revolutionary. What I think is interesting about the five elements concept is the notions of xiangshen, which means an enabling interaction, and xiangke, which is the overcoming interactions. So within the five elements framework, the key idea is that none of these states are permanent, right? They are all interactive, and they enable each other, and they may overcome each other. So they are very important. They form a framework of balance, and they have interactions which make them harmonious or discordant. And later on, I'd like to use this type of ideas to look at flavor matching and wine and food matching as well. So in essence, xiangshen, i.e. the enabling or generating interactions, we can talk about things like congruency, right? Things being congruent or complementary. In terms of the overcoming interactions, we can talk about canceling effects or discordant effects, right? So we'll revisit these later, but as I go through the wines now, and if you're eating, if you're having a Chinese feast right now, just maybe bear in mind these generating, enabling, and overcoming elements, and think about these concepts while you are going through your food and your wine pairings. So let's leave those ideas for now, and we'll come back to them again. And we'll first move on to the wines. And first of all, we're going to Ningxia province. So I'd like to invite you to try the first two white wines, maybe together. They're both from Ningxia. They're both from the Helan Mountain East appellation, which is now an official Chinese wine appellation. So Ningxia is arguably the most famous, internationally famous wine regions of China. It's sort of center north of China, very continental climate, very long sunshine hours, you know, annually over 3,000 hours of sunshine, and very little rainfall, less than 200 millimeters. But summers are hot but quite short. The winters are quite harsh and long. So the growing season is quite short, but you do have great daylight and sunshine hours, and the day-night diurnal temperature difference is fairly great, which enables a good complexity to develop and ripening whilst retaining freshness and acidity. And because of the mountain range, some of these vineyards are at quite high altitude as well. And at the moment, there are 92 operational wineries, but over 100 are still in the pipeline of being built. They've set aside 38,000 hectares of vineyards, you know, for Ningxia. So this is definitely becoming a flagship wine region of China. So Chinese people like slogans to help us remember things. So Ningxia, we can remember Ningxia as having one mountain, the Helan Mountain, one river, which is the Yellow River, that provides a water resource for irrigation. So irrigation is certainly allowed in China and sometimes necessary. So Yellow River provides a constant source for irrigation when needed. And one corridor, which is now the appellation of Helan Shan Donglu, which is the Helan Mountain East. So the first wine we're tasting is a dry Riesling. So of course, Riesling is usually, you know, the go-to wine with Chinese food. This is a dry style made by Canan Winery, 2018. So this Canan Winery is actually the first winery to plant Riesling in Ningxia, and it's founded in 2011. the owner and winemaker is called Wang Fang. And she sometimes, her nickname is Crazy Fang. People called her crazy because she was the first to say, hey, let's try Riesling in Ningxia. Because previously, Chinese wine regions tend to stick to Cabernet Sauvignon, right? Wanting to make the Bordeaux blend as a sort of rite of passage for a wine region to show that they can make a serious wine. So predominantly, you know, vineyards were planting Cabernet Sauvignon. But Wang Fang, having studied in Germany and fell in love with Riesling, she decided to come back from Germany, start a winery without any prior experience in wine. And but maybe as a result, she was fearless and she said, why not? Why don't we try Riesling? And this Riesling was among the first to win international accolades in the Riesling category, and showed other vineyards, you know, actually Riesling does have a future in China and in Ningxia as well. So let's taste this wine together. The other thing is, maybe you have noticed this photo. You might have noticed that in winter, so on the left is summer, on the right is winter. The vineyard looks rather different in winter. Where have all the vines gone? So this is how vines have to survive winter in China, which is, they have to be buried. They have to be covered by earth because the winters are very cold and also dry. So the dryness and the coldness will kill the vines. So what they have to do is to push the vines down and cover it with earth. And this is highly labor intensive, as you can see, as you can imagine. It's all done, mostly by hand, and needs to be very careful. So it's very costly, and sometimes it does mean that some vines will be damaged as well in the process. But this is a very necessary process every year in Ningxia and most of northern China, where in the winter months, the vines are buried and then dug up again in springtime. And let's also taste the second white wine side by side, which is from Silver Heights Vineyard and also in Ningxia. This is 100% Chardonnay, aged in Burgundy oak barrels for 12 months. And you see the style is quite Burgundian. You know, it has a lovely golden yellow color, very ripe and almost, stony fruits, almost tropical, slightly tropical fruits on the nose, rather Burgundian in style, but the oak, I think, is wonderfully judged, you know, just a hint of creaminess. So a rather beautiful Chardonnay from Ningxia. So Silver Heights Vineyard is established in 2007, one of the earliest privately owned, family owned vineyards in China. And it's at a height of over 1,200 meters. So Silver Heights, Gao Di, Gao means height. And Gao is also the family surname of the owners. So it's called Silver Heights, Yingse Gao Di. And the owner is, this lady, Emma Gao. Emma Gao is also a very influential figure in Chinese wine. And she is the first to convert the vineyard into biodynamic practices. And she herself does Tai Chi, and she is an avid believer in the Chinese agricultural calendar and season system, and she incorporates that into her biodynamic practices. So Silver Heights is a really fascinating and pioneering winery in China. So if you're having the food, I think these two white wines would be rather lovely with the with what we have on our menu, freshly prepared by Lu Ban Kitchen for you. I think it goes quite well with some of the sort of snack and starter type of dishes like the dumpling, the chicken wings, and also the crispy pork belly, but without the sauce. I personally think the sauce is slightly too distracting and overwhelming for wines, but I think the crispy pork belly offered in our food banquet box is perfectly delicious on its own, and would go rather well with these two wines. But by all means, please comment if you're having the food and the wines together. Please comment what you are trying together and what works and what doesn't seem to work, etc. I think it would be really nice to have an interactive session, especially with the food and wine matching conversation. So that's the two white wines. And now let's move on to the first red wines. So we're going to Shanxi, which is a historically important region for winemaking. Taiyuan has been a historical wine region because it was en route from the Silk Road. And wine was brought, European style wine and European grape varieties came into China through the Silk Road as early as 3rd century BC. Right, so Taiyuan was sort of on that path and was a historical wine region as well. But what's very interesting about Shanxi province is this low plateau terroir, right? So if you ask why do we need to drink Chinese wine, what's interesting about Chinese wine? I think going forward, it has to be the unique terroir that China has to offer. China is such a huge country with such varied and dramatic terrains. And I think the low plateau will offer one such very interesting terroir for years to come for us to try. So the Lowe's Plateau, this region wrapped in red, is the world's largest Lowe's Plateau, right? 400,000 kilometers squared, and at an average elevation of 1,200 meters. So wines here, this one we are tasting, is again a high altitude wine. The thickness of the Lowe's is around 50 to 80 meters on average, but here at Rongzi Winery, where this wine is from, the Lowe's is as thick as 200 meters. So you can see in this picture, this is the vineyard on the Lowe's soil bed. So Chateau Rongzi, founded in 2007. And interestingly, their consultant is Jean-Claude Berriet of Petrus fame, of course. This is a Pinot Noir, 100% Pinot Noir. It's quite unusual for Chinese wineries to make Pinot Noir. And I think this is a rather fine example as well. You know, very, very fruit driven, very elegant. Because of the low soil, it retains great freshness and acidity, and because of the high elevation and the microclimate around this winery is sort of a cool climate. So this Pinot Noir is very much like a cool climate Pinot Noir with very fresh fruit, strawberry notes, but great acidity and elegance and finesse as well. Fairly low alcohol, 12%. So it's quite approachable and well-made and a Pinot Noir, because as we know, Pinot Noir is pretty difficult to make. And in China, not many wineries have successfully produced Pinot Noir yet. So this is a really exciting example of Pinot Noir from China. So if you're eating the feast box from Luban, I think this Pinot Noir is quite versatile for food. You know, it would go very well with the duck and pancake, for example, or even the vegan version of the duck, which is the faux duck made from jackfruit, but also served like duck and pancakes. Char siu bao with this aromatic roast pork, and again the pork belly without the sauce. I think you know, it's a quite a versatile food wine. very fresh, very fine tannins, very easy to pair with food. So, okay, on to the next wine. We're going to Hebei province. So Hebei province is west of Beijing. And we're going to Huailai in Hebei province. So here on the top right map, you can see its relative distance to Beijing. So Beijing is the green circle on the top right corner. Huailai is the circle in the center with a reservoir area. So there's a bit of a body of water, which produce an effect on the local climate. You know, it makes the temperature more temperate. And what's very interesting about this area is that it's quite close to a very popular stretch of the Great Wall. So one itinerary suggestion I have is if next time you go to Beijing or you want to go to the Great Wall, why not drive another hour west and you'll be able to visit some wineries and vineyards in Huailai province as well. So this is from Martin Winery, a Tempranillo. Again, unusual variety for China, but Tempranillo seems to be doing rather well in this part of the world. This is a 12 months oak barrel aged. Quite dark, plummy, fresh fruits. On the nose. Again, what you'll find with a lot of Chinese wines is that they do try to make it quite fruit forward and soft tanning. So it's easy to go with food because most Chinese people drink wine with food. You know, that's usually the setting. It's a banquet setting where we have wine. So Chinese winemakers do tend to make wines which are more approachable and food friendly in general. So you'll find this wine, again, quite good depth and length, very fruit driven, very good concentration of dark fruits. But again, the tannins is quite soft and rounded. So Martin Winery has an interesting story. It has a British connection. It was inspired by a visit by Sir Ted Heath, the former prime minister. So he visited this region in 1996 and said, oh, I reckon this place could be good for viticulture. And the very next year, Martin Winery was founded, and it was a Sino-British joint venture initially. Now it's Chinese owned, but it started off being a Sino-British project. So that's just an interesting fact. So this wine, I think, again, is quite a nice food wine. It has a bit more concentration and body than the Rongzi, so perhaps can go with a slightly more substantial meat, you know, like pork ribs, but again, be fine with the duck and the char siu, the aromatic roast pork as well. You know, especially things like smoked dishes, smoked pork ribs, or even duck, you know, roast duck generally is smoked over cherry wood, for example. So that smokiness and the slight hint of oaky smokiness in the wine, I think they seem to complement each other quite nicely. And then on to our next wine, which is from Beijing, actually, from just the suburb of Beijing called Fangshan. So Jing, by the way, is capital. So Beijing means the northern capital because of its location being in the north of China. So Fangshan is an area right outside Beijing. And this is Chateau Bolongbao, which is it's an organic red wine. And Chateau Bolongbao, interestingly, is the first Chinese vineyard to receive EU, US, and China organic certifications. very interestingly, Fangshan, because it's right on the outskirts of Beijing. So you can imagine the vineyards themselves are not very big. You know, there are 19 wineries, they're all fairly small. But what they want to do, where they want to differentiate themselves, is in the area of sustainability and high tech. So below you can see in center is a picture of where they were putting precision temperature, humidity measurements in tiny little plots. So they have very close data feed with the meteorologic office. So trying to do big data on viticulture. So they're very much into sustainability and technology in this area. And being close to Beijing, you know, they are also keen to develop tourism. So rather interestingly, in 2020, you know, in the midst of sort of, well, for us, at least in the UK, we were still almost in lockdown. Fangshan held its first wine festival during September and October, and it attracted 30,000 visitors, you know, for the winery. So you can see, you know, people were donning their face masks, but they were certainly not deterred from trying some wines. And the children, you know, it's a family day out. The children are out as well, having a lot of fun in the wineries too. So, Bolongbao, this wine is rather interesting. I'll be keen to hear what you think, because to me, there's a bit of bread on this wine. So bread, you know, but it's not a lot. So you do get a bit of a wet hay, you know, aged sort of saddle leather sort of dimension, at the expense of maybe the fruitiness. The fruit is a little bit subdued, but I think it's a rather lovely wine. Nevertheless, it has good complexity and layers and good length. And in a way, that bread dimension makes it a little bit more savory, right? So I think this wine would go rather nicely with things like the jiang beef, right? So slow cooked beef, and also maybe substantial meat dishes like the baby rib with a bit of smokiness because it's being smoked with jasmine wood. So something smoky, gamey, would go rather nicely with this wine with a touch of bread. Okay. And the last wine we're having, we're at this beautiful, magical, almost fairy tale chateau, but it is in China. It is in China. And we're going back to Ningxia again. We're going to Ningxia and we're going to Chateau Changyu Moser 15. And this is one of the new wine just released last year. It's 2016. Purple Air Comes from the East. So Changyu, you may already know, is the first winery to export internationally. In fact, Changyu is called Changyu Pioneer Wine Company. So they were the first Chinese industrialized winery founded in 1892. So they're always doing things a little bit ahead of the rest, right? So being the first winery founded in China, the first to import many major grape European varieties into China, the first to export certainly into the UK, their estate range. And now they have several, quite a wide range, you know, some more accessible wines starting from £12, going all the way to their Grand Vin, which is around £70. But last year they launched this icon wine, the icon wine, which is Purple Air Comes from the East. It's 100% Cabernet Sauvignon and a new French oak aged for 24 months. And the selected from 10 parcels, 10 of the best parcels from their vineyard. And this winery, the chief winemaker is Lenz Moser. So Lenz Moser really truly believes in the Ningxia terroir. And in launching this icon wine, what he wants to show is more the freshness of the fruit. So usually when we think of icon wine, we might think really bold, you know, lots of oak, quite heavy. But actually, if you try this wine, you'll notice that the oak is quite subtle and you get more freshness of the Cabernet Sauvignon. This is trying to tell you what Ningxia Cabernet tastes like when it's fresh and concentrated and picked from the best plots. You know, so it's a terroir wine, it's a varietal wine that really wants to tell you a story of Ningxia. And what is also quite interesting for me in this wine is that Lenz quite specifically said, this is going to be a wine that can be aged. Right, because so far we don't really know whether Chinese wines have longevity. You know, it's sort of the next question, right? The first question is, what does Chinese wine taste like? What does it stand for? Right. So we're not too worried about can Chinese wine age or not. But Lenz, in making this icon wine, is making a statement to say, I do believe we can make a wine for the cellar to be cellared, you know, for a decade or two, perhaps more. So I'll be interested to hear what you think of this icon wine from Chateau Changyu Moser. And maybe you've tried some of their other wines in the range, and I have certainly presented some in previous talks. But this is their latest addition to
the... We have a question. Can you go back to the info slide?
Sure. For Changyu, is it?
Yeah, I think this is the one. Oh.
So I'm just looking at the comments in case I missed any. Okay, can you go back to the info slide? Yes. So this is for Changyu Moser 15. The chateau was built, well, opened in 2013. Their first vintage was actually in 2008, but they built this wonderful chateau and opened in 2013. So yeah, they've got 60 hectares planted within the estate, but a further 190 under direct management as well, making a total of 250 hectares. Yes, so let's move on. Right, so this wine, I think, again, quite a versatile food wine from the Luban box. I think it will go very nicely with quite a lot of the meaty or more substantial dishes, the duck, the pork belly, the pork ribs, etc. But I haven't, because of logistics issues, I haven't tried every single dish with the wines at the same time. So if you're having different foods and different pairings, please do comment and tell us what works and what doesn't work. You know, so it'll be fun to hear what you think. Okay, so I do have a bonus wine recommendation, because every year at Chinese New Year time, I get asked about what's a zodiac wine that we should try this year. And as you can imagine, last year being the year of the rat, it was quite difficult to recommend a rat wine, a rat labeled wine. But this year being the year of the ox, you know, it's a noble animal, magnificent animal. So I do have a very good zodiac wine to recommend. And also niu in Chinese means ox, bull, or anything bovine. But niu colloquially also means awesome. So we can say in the year of the ox, we can drink awesome wine. So niu has this double second meaning in the Chinese language as well. And this is not a Chinese wine, actually. It's called the Mighty Ox, St. Helet from Barossa Valley. And I'm sure most of you know St. Helet is sort of the quintessential Shiraz maker in Barossa Valley. And this is one of their latest new addition called the Mighty Ox. So I think for this year, if you like Australian style Shiraz, you know, this is the wine to try, and perhaps even to lay down for the next round of the Year of the Ox. I think it could have that longevity as well. And this, I would suggest pairing with Chinese hot pot, because hot pot is all about, you know, warmth, the feeling of coziness. So you can drink a full-bodied, rather well-rounded wine, you know, a big wine. And also we have a saying called 大鱼大肉, which means literally big fish, big meat, i.e. a Chinese feast, where the seafood is usually cooked in some rather rich sauce. So the seafood can withstand pairing with a red wine as well, a quite full-bodied red wine. So 大鱼大肉, you know, like a Chinese feast involving big fish and big meat, you know, that sort of thing, would all go quite nicely with a big bold a wine as well. So there you go. That's a Zodiac wine recommendation as well. So, okay, so now having whizzed through the wine regions and the wines, now we can sort of slow down a bit, and maybe you'd like to revisit, retaste some of the wines, have some of the foods, and now let's talk about the five elements a little bit more. Of food and wine pairing. So going back to this cycle of a flavor profiles. So in this chart, right, one of the things we can talk about is how flavors enable each other. So if you go in the sort of clockwise direction from the top, we have something called sour bitter confusion with our palate, you know, so things which are extremely sour start to taste bitter, right? So if you work through from the top, you can say the sour flavor, sour taste profile give rise to bitterness, because on the pH scale, sort of 0 to 7, you know, you tend to detect acidity. And then beyond 7 and above, is things start to taste bitter. So around 7-ish, that's where the sour bitter confusion sort of arises. That's when sour merges into bitterness. And that's why when we talk about generating or enabling relationships, so acidic profile going into bitter profile or tannic profile. And then going round again, bitterness into sweetness. So sometimes, especially in tea, right, in Chinese tea, a lot of tannic teas, the aftertaste is very long but sweet at the end. We have this sweetness at the end. And in Chinese, we have a saying which is first comes bitterness and then ends with sweetness, right? This is sort of kind of a physical description of what's going on when you have something tannic, but it's also a bit philosophical, you know, first hardship and then sweetness. So that generating relationship holds as well. And sweetness into umami, savory, and spiciness, you know, the reason why sweet chili seems to be a nice combination, again, that's the enabling, the mutually enabling quality of sweetness going into spiciness that somehow make the piquant sensation more sharper and more pleasant, but also temperate, you know, not too harsh. And then umami going into savoriness is something we talk a lot about, especially in wine, right? We talk about umami, minerality, and savoriness. So they kind of generate and enable each other. And minerality tend to then enable sort of or generate or complement acidic qualities, right, in wine especially. So this is how I would sort of interpret this generating effect. And then if you look at the dotted red lines, they are the overcoming or cancelling effects, you know. So for example, sour and sweetness, they cancel out. Similarly, savory, saltiness and sweetness would cancel out. Umami notes tend to clash with acidity, and tannic or bitterness tend to clash with saltiness or umami or spiciness. So they tend to sort of either cancel each other or clash with each other, right? So that's sort of how this cycle, generating cycle and the overcoming cycle would work among these elements. But more interestingly, like I said, I think the five elements is really about relationships and changeability and how they achieve harmony and balance, or how they distort balance, right? So this notion of xiangshen, you know, enabling, and xiangke, sort of overcoming. So let's have a very quick look at some of these examples. And also what's interesting is that generating doesn't always mean better. You know, we shouldn't always just strive for generating elements, because too much of a good thing may not be better. You know, too much of a good thing actually could be off balance, whereas canceling or clashing tastes are not necessarily bad. So we shouldn't always avoid xiangke, i.e. canceling elements either, because sometimes when things clash or cancel out, actually you achieve the middle ground, which is balance, right? So xiangshen, xiangke are not in themselves positive or negative. They are just different sort of relationships, right? And that's a very important philosophical notion, which is to say, you know, in yin and yang, you know, yang is not always better, and yin is not always undesirable. You know, they are mutually dependent and mutually beneficial and interchangeable, right? So, for example, if we're talking about congruency, right? So sour acidity, let's say acidity in food, can make a lesser wine quite flabby. So usually the wine's acidity needs to be able to be stronger than the food acidity. Otherwise, the food tend to make the wine flabby, right? So this is when we talk about congruency, which is sort of acidity on acidity, right? But the wine acidity needs to be slightly bigger than the food acidity for the wine still to taste, to stand up to the food. And congruency, again, same thing, sweetness on sweetness. We tend to say that if you're having a dessert and a sweet wine, then the sweet wine needs to be a bit sweeter than the dessert. But then sometimes that could be just too much. If your dessert is too sweet and then you pile on top of even sweeter wine, you know, it will start to get very cloying. So usually, you know, I would do the other way around, which is decide what sweet wine I'm having and order a slightly less sweet dessert to go with it. So again, congruency, you know, too much of a good thing would be too much in this scenario. So it's managing, managing those relationships when you're piling one on top of another. Similarly, creaminess and the creamy and creaminess in food and creaminess in the wine from the oak, you know, they tend to find affinity, but again, you might not want too much of that. And when we talk about congruency, we can also talk about weight, you know, matching food of a certain weight to wine of a certain weight. You want to make sure the wine, the body of the wine, can stand up to the body of the food. And similarly with intensity of the food, bold food and bold wine, you know, that sort of thing. And that's very important in Chinese cuisine, because apart from the weight and the intensity, also the mouthfeel, you know, sometimes, for example, in Cantonese cuisine, you will have this very smooth mouthfeel, overall mouthfeel, because the sauces tend to always want to coat your mouth in this roundness. And so therefore, when you're picking a wine, you want something that's also round and smooth. You don't want grainy tannins, for example, that would completely defeat what the food is trying to achieve, for example. So congruency is one aspect. And then also, how about complementary elements? For example, saltiness tend to have an amplifying effect on sweetness, especially in sour profiles, right? So they are complementary because sometimes, you know, if the wine is just subtly or delicately sweet or sour with a salty food, it might amplify those features in the wine. So that could be quite pleasant. Similarly, you know, tannic wines tend to cut through fat and also acidity. Oh, sorry, fat tend to round off tannins, doesn't it? And acidity tend to cut through grease and fat, right? So they are also rather complementary. But some canceling effects, like I was saying, this overcoming canceling effects could be quite pleasant. You know, for example, acidity and sweetness, they can work very well together, right? A lot of the things that we celebrate in the tastes of oranges, you know, Chinese bayberry, just to throw in something exotic, and Riesling, you know, for example, we do appreciate that sweet, sour sort of clashing, but somehow very well integrated flavor profiles. So they are to be celebrated and enjoyed. And similarly, other well-paired profiles like chili, piquant spiciness can be rounded off by sweeter wines or more acidic wines. You know, they tend to coat your mouth and makes the dish less spicy if you're having sort of Sichuan food, for example. You want to pair with a sweeter wine with good acidity for that reason. But then, of course, with the overcoming, canceling, or discordant factors, they can create unpleasant taste combinations. You know, so like very tannic wines tend not to go terribly well with spicy or sour food, or umami, or even salty food, or seafood. You know, I'm sure you all know what happens having seafood with very tannic wines. You get this metallic, sometimes this blood taste, you know, it's not very good at all. So all these discordant pairings we do want to avoid. Right, so all that is to say, you know, apart from just looking at profiles and their relationships, you know, canceling could be good, or congruency could be push you off balance, right? So we have to sort of consider aromas, flavors, intensity, texture, but also things like ingredients, what's the food served with, the sauce, the seasoning, the garnish, even the cooking methods, and sometimes the ambiance, right? If it's a hot summer's day, you probably just want anything that's cold, right? So lots of things to create a harmonious whole. And that's the fun and the challenge of wine and food matching, especially with Chinese food, I think, you know, with all the regional flavors and possibilities. Yeah, so it's all rather good fun. Okay, and I just quickly mentioned, as you might have noticed, that many of my slides had Chinese characters and pronunciation on them. And that's an example of some of the free webinars I'm running at the moment on a fortnightly basis at the moment, trying to combine these wine concepts with a bit of Chinese language and Chinese culture. So if you are hoping to pick up some wine words in Chinese, for example, you're very welcome to join my webinar series called A Note of Mandarin in My Wine. So, you know, do check it out if you're interested. They are fortnightly on a Sunday, run with the Cambridge China Center. You can check it out on the website. I'll quickly mention my book, and some of you who ordered the food boxes, each of the food boxes will come in one of these red packets, which we give away at Chinese New Year with gifts and money usually. So in one of these red packets, one of you will win a copy of my book. But for the rest of you, I just want to do a quick plug of my book called The Chinese Wine Renaissance. Again, it's to tell you about the wine regions, the wine stories of China, but more importantly, the cultural and historical background of China. To tell you why wine is enjoying a renaissance in China, where did it come from, you know, why it's here and where it's heading to. So if you want to just know about China in general, but find most books a bit too heavy going or boring, and your interest is in wine, this is a good way to get into China via a wine narrative, I suppose. So that's the book. And I will kind of end here and take some questions. So all that is to say, you know, wine and food, Chinese wine and food matching. I know we talk about, you know, this is probably a pointless exercise, because when we eat, when the Chinese eat, you know, it's all over the place. We serve so many dishes at once. But I would say, actually, we can unpick some of those elements. For example, we tend to serve food in waves, right? So first, the cold dishes, the appetizers. So earlier we showed two white wines, which would go quite nicely with appetizers or dim sum or small bites. And then you might have a main dish, like a head dish, like the Peking duck. And then you would serve a particular wine to that head dish, you know, the headline dish. And then later on, you would be presented with lots of different dishes, but generally they still belong to one particular cuisine type, right? So you can still say within this cuisine type, these are the underlying sources or texture or whatever that belong to this cuisine group. And for that, for those prominent characters, you can match those qualities to certain wines, right? So it's not completely sort of a lost cause, I suppose. And I think it's also just a bit of fun. And really, when you are drinking wine with Chinese banquet, the idea is really not to have a particular dish with a particular wine. It's almost a mix and match exercise. You know, you might pick something sour and say, oh, actually, I'm gonna have a sip of this wine because it goes with this particular flavor. And if you happen to pick up another a flavor in another dish that doesn't go with the wine, then just skip the wine, you know. So just like eating the picking and selecting the dishes, whether or not you choose to have a sip of wine with it, you know, is also part of the exercise, I suppose. So so I think Chinese wine and food matching is still quite a fun thing to do. Great, so I will end there and be really happy to take any questions or hear your comments about the wines and maybe the food as well. So I'm gonna stop sharing my screen and we can.
Actually, yes, we have a question from Lindsay. She asked, what would you recommend with the Mapo tofu?
All right, okay, so Mapo tofu, they had a change of recipe, which I didn't have time to taste it with the wines. But this particular Mapo tofu they served is not very spicy. So if it was a really spicy sort of Mapo tofu, then I would have recommended the Riesling, you know, something acidic, something quite refreshing. But this particular Mapo tofu, I think, is quite aromatic. You know, it has that hint of heat, but the heat is not there, it's more aromatic. So I would go with maybe the Pinot Noir, either the Pinot Noir or maybe the Tempranillo, the Martin Tempranillo, I think would work with those. Let me know what you think. any other comments to my mind? Both of the Chardonnay of a caramel finish. Ah, right, interesting. Yes, I would say, so Kevin has said that there's a caramel sort of aftertaste to the Chardonnay and the Cabernet. So yes, because especially the food that we have tonight, some of the dishes are made in a Cantonese style. So the Cantonese style, I don't know if you remember from my map with the circles. So sweet, savory is a major feature of the south and southeast part of China. So savory sweet is the common food flavor combination. So if you find a caramel finish in the wine, that would go rather well with Cantonese cuisine. So for example, the char siu bao, which is this aromatic roast pork bun, you know, that pork is a classic example of a savory sweet taste profile. Yeah.
We have another question. Kevin says, to his mind, both the Chardonnay and the Cabernet have a caramel finish. So yeah. Is this to suit Chinese tastes?
Yeah, so that's what I was just answering, which is I think so. Yeah, the savory sweetness of certain cuisine type would absolutely go very well with that profile, taste profile. So I'm seeing on the on the chat, thank you, David Sayer. Thank you for the lovely comments. I'm seeing some really positive comments. That's great. Where do Chinese winemakers feel their early adopter markets will be? Okay, so most of the Chinese wines, quite frankly, are consumed within China, right? So UK actually is one of the more... UK actually has more Chinese wines than any other sort of international markets at the moment, because a lot of these winemakers consider UK to be a good first step towards the international market for several reasons. One is that because UK is not really a producing region, well, yet. So the UK market is very open to trying wines from all over the world. They're quite open-minded, especially now, you know, new world countries are embraced rather than sort of shunned upon, you know. So sort of cracking the UK market seems to be an interesting challenge for a lot of these winemakers. And secondly, being an English speaking country, and with the, you know, the wine critics community are internationally respected. So any comments from English wine writers, you know, British wine writers tend to carry quite a lot of weight for them as well. So for several reasons, before Brexit, it was an even better idea to come to the UK first. But that's sort of slightly questionable at the moment. But still, I would say we have the widest range of Chinese wines available in the UK than anywhere else outside of China. Great. So, yeah.
Pretty much answered everything also from the chat.
Great.
So, yeah, I just think everybody was so silent in the beginning because they were preparing the food and it was great. I loved your PowerPoint, a really nice presentation, very educational. So thank you so much.
No, it's a pleasure. A
celebration evening. I hope you will get also your dinner with
yes, I had some earlier. Yeah, so you see some of my wines are already you know, quite low. The feel is quite low because earlier I had a little sip with my family. Thank you very much. I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was quite a fast whiz through because I wanted to talk about the regions and the food and wine matching elements. So I hope it wasn't too quick. So I hope everybody had the time to drink.
Information. Thank you so much for this.
Yeah, fantastic. Thank you.
Hopefully to see you more and have a great evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Happy New Year. Take care. Good night.